the folks who weren't able to attend. That's why we like the webinar format, because we can record it and post it, because we know it's hard to get everybody in one spot at one time. So, okay, and Alan Shapiro is here. He's going to be helping me kind of address questions in the chat, because sometimes it's hard to monitor, to go through a presentation and monitor questions. So again, if the questions get too difficult, we're going to follow up with you offline, and then we'll make sure to post that answer somewhere in the recorded webinar or as a side piece to the recorded webinar. So I know a lot of people have questions about adding videos to their course, and some of those questions are very course specific. So if that's the case, again, we'll follow up with you offline. And if it's something that would be good for the general population, we'll make sure to include that in our recorded links. Okay, Lori's good. Okay, so let's get started. I'm going to switch what I'm sharing here. And this is our first webinar for the new Summer Learning Series. So thank you for taking part in this. We recently got a license of Adobe Connect, which we have been asking for a long time, because we wanted to do webinars when we wanted them easily accessible by faculty, by staff, by whoever wants to attend these. So we recently got a license of Adobe Connect through the library. They were nice enough to share with us some of their licensing. And now we can host these types of webinars, and we will be throughout the coming months. The Summer Learning Series is a great new thing we just launched this summer. It's going to consist of pedagogy topics as well as, and now of course I can't find the document I'm looking for. It's going to consist of pedagogy document or question or topics, sorry, as well as technology topics. So we want to give you guys a nice variety. I know you tend to hear the same thing over and over again, and we want to try to clarify that as much as possible, give you something a little bit different to look forward to from month to month. So today we're talking about Jing and SnagIt. I finally got my PowerPoint up here. Okay. And can everybody see my screen? Okay, perfect. And if I go too quickly, just type in the chat window and tell me to slow down. I know sometimes I'll click through and it'll go too fast for people to follow, or it'll take a little bit longer to load on your computer than it does on mine. So if it starts going too quickly, please just say stop, stop, slow down, and I will make sure to do that. Okay. And again, Alan is in the chat window. He's going to be helping me with some of the questions. So again, today's session is on Jing and SnagIt. By maybe a show of hands, if you use the raise your hand little icon in the top part of your Adobe Connect session, who uses Jing or SnagIt already in their course? So it looks like several of you already use these tools. And that's really good. These are great tools for using with your students. They're very quick, they're very easy to learn, and they don't take a lot of time up from doing other things that we all have to do as faculty. So we're going to talk about more about these tools, because we get a lot of questions from faculty, you know, when should I use Jing versus when should I use SnagIt, which is better, and that really depends on what you're trying to do. Okay. And I'm sure I've talked to most of you before. I know everybody's name. I've probably sent you a Jing at some point in the future. I love Jing. It is my favorite program ever invented. It was developed by a bunch of computer engineers at TechSmith. When they were doing help desk calls, they actually just got tired of answering the same questions over and over, or answering questions and trying to describe, you know, click in the top left, but not quite to the left, maybe a little bit to the right, maybe in the center, but click the button that says okay, and it's the blue button. And that gets really hard to describe over text, especially in an email. I'm sure you've all experienced that with your students. Trying to describe exactly where something is in your course via text isn't always the easiest thing in the world. And that's where Jing came in. Jing was developed by basically folks working at a help desk to help them do their jobs better. I started using Jing probably 11 years ago. I've met the original developer and gave him a hug because he's my favorite person. Because I've used this product for 11 years and it has helped tremendously. Now, Jing's gone through a lot of changes over the past year, and we'll talk a little bit about those and maybe why, if you're currently using Jing, maybe why SnagIt is your next natural stepping stone for you. So, what we're going to be talking about today is what is Jing? Some of the pros and cons of both Jing and SnagIt, why you'd use one over the other. Oh, Linda, I got a raised hand. And I can't hear you, Linda, so you have to type into the chat window. Just fine. Okay. So we're going to talk about some of the pros and cons of Jing and Snagit, why you'd use one over the other. And that's a very important decision for you to make. When you're making these videos, you want to make sure you're choosing the right tool for the job. Where you can get help. Thank you, Alan. Alan's keeping me on track over here. Where you can get help with Jing and Snagit. Both products were created by a company called TechSmith. And TechSmith, if you use Camtasia, TechSmith also created Camtasia. It's a great company, and they have lots and lots and lots of tutorials to help you get started. And of course, you can ask any one of us, Alan, myself, Amy Drexler, or Larry Ducey. We all use these tools probably every day of our lives in both our teaching as well as in helping faculty and developing courses. So you can also ask us, but just remember, TechSmith has a lot of tutorials to get you started. And then what's the next step? So I've done these tools. What can I do to enhance them? We'll also talk a little bit about that. So the first thing, we'll start with Jing because Jing is quick and easy. It's one of those, I've got Jing on my computer and I can do pretty much everything I need to do. Jing is easy to use. I've shown people Jing in 10 minutes or less, and they tend to love it. We'll go over a couple of things when you're using Jing to just be aware of, but Jing is very easy to use. When you save a Jing, it stores automatically on the Screencast Cloud. So just like the Google Cloud where your email is stored, Screencast or TechSmith has a cloud called Screencast where they store your videos. So you don't have to have a spot on YouTube to put these videos. They're automatically put up in the cloud and you can access them from anywhere. You can capture and annotate images as well as videos. So a lot of people don't, they use Jing for their videos, but they don't know. You can also get images with Jing, and that's really helpful as well. The best thing about Jing is it's free, and this is why I've used it for 11 years. It's a free tool that helps me do my job better, and that's why I love it. So some of the cons to Jing, it is only 5 minutes. Now, I debated on whether to put that in a pro or con column because I don't always think that a limit of 5 minutes is a bad thing. I think a lot of videos go too long, and students do not have long attention spans at all. So we want to keep our videos short. I think Jing forces you to keep your videos short and narrowed, but sometimes you do need to go maybe 7 minutes and you just need those extra 2 minutes, and Jing isn't enough. You can't download the MP4. And if you're not familiar with an MP4, it's just the video file that you get. You can edit that. You can upload it to YouTube. You can do other things with it. It's the next step that we'll get to talk about at the end. Bandwidth. If you're using Jing for your class, and just a show of hands, who puts links to their Jing videos in their courses? Okay, Lori and Beth, and I've seen them in your courses. Bandwidth, you only get so much bandwidth a month with your Jing account, with your Screencast Cloud account. You only get I think it's two, and Alan, correct me if I'm wrong. I think it's about 2 megabytes a month. which will go surprisingly fast when you put one link to one video. Thank you, Alan. One link to one video in your course. So maybe you have a video introducing your students to the course, and they all, all 30 students will click on that link and watch that. Your 2 megabytes of data will go very, very quickly. And that's one of the drawbacks to Jing. So it's great for those one-on-one. Remember, it was created for a help desk. It was created for me to answer one specific question for one specific person. It wasn't really intended to answer questions for 30 people. So keep that in mind as you're using Jing. If you do put it up in your course, that bandwidth is going to go really quick. Now, my workaround to that, because again, I use Jing every single day, is to have 4 different accounts. So when one account uses up its bandwidth, I switch to another account. But I am trying to get away from that and use more SnagIt for those videos that I want to reuse term to term. It does create a flash file, and I know we're all getting to that point. Most of us know you cannot play flash files on your cell phone. So you send a student a video, they cannot play that video on their cell phone or their tablet. And that's a real drawback for students. A lot of them access their courses nowadays on a tablet or on a smartphone, and they cannot access a Jing that way. So just keep that in mind. And the last drawback is you can't caption this video. So while Jings are really great for, you have one student who asks you one question on something very specific, you can send them a Jing to quickly answer that question. They're not really intended for using with the wider class audience, where you may have a student who's deaf or needs some kind of accommodation that requires you to caption the video. Jings don't allow for that. So they're great for that one-on-one, maybe one of on a few, but they're not great for one-on-many. Okay, and where do you get Jing? I've provided the link here. And Alan, can you type that link into the chat window as well? That way we can, if you need to, you can copy and paste it. If you want to go out and get Jing, it's available on TextMiss website. It's completely free. You'll download it, you'll install it on your computer, and you will be ready to go. And thank you. It's now in the chat window if you want to grab that, because I know if I don't stay on this slide. Okay, so let's take a look at Jing. So I'm going to exit out of this. And sorry to switch how much I'm sharing here. I'm going to share my screen. Let me remember which monitor is which. I only have three right now, and you don't need to see that. Okay, sorry, I've got too much open. Okay, so this is Jing. Can everybody see that okay? It's not showing me what I'm sharing, so. Okay, thank you. Okay, so everybody see the background, see my fish. His name is Sergey. He's my partner when I'm working. I never see my desktop, so I'm always surprised about which desktop background I currently have. But this is my fish, and it's the only fish I really want to keep alive. So we're going to go up here. When you install Jing, Jing's a lot of fun because what it does when you run Jing, it puts this little sun, little icon, and it usually goes up here. Now, if you're using multiple monitors, look for the sun because it will go on whichever monitor it feels like. Usually your primary monitor if you're using multiple, but sometimes it can get switched around. And you can move this sun by clicking and then just dragging around. You can move it, but it's always up here at the top. And that's really useful because, again, Jing's one of those things that you're going to use. I have a quick question. I need to answer it real quick. I'm going to grab that Jing and do a video for my students. So when you install Jing, it's got three options. It's got capture, it's got history, and we're going to go more into history in just a minute. And it's got more. More is basically just you can send Jing feedback if you want. You can go into your preferences where you can set up your audio preferences. If you've got a new mic, you can set up new accounts if you want, and you can customize different buttons. Again, TechSmith offers a lot of helpful tutorials to help you get started on these products. So there is a help link directly in Jing. If you're wondering how to do something, you can click on their help and go straight to their tutorials from here. Or if you don't want this little sun to appear at the top of your desktop, you can click the log out button and get rid of it. It's still on your computer, it's just the sun isn't at the top of your monitor. Okay, I'm going to click this check mark to finish. History. I love history because a lot of times I'll do a video that answers one person's question, and then I'll get that question a day or two later for another person, and I can send that same video out. This is really helpful, especially right at the beginning of the semester when we get there tends to be a trend with questions. So I use the history quite a bit with Jing, and I don't think a lot of people know about this option, so I did want to go into a little more depth with it. If you click this little middle mini sun here, you'll get to the history of your Jings. And this is all the Jings that you've created. I have to wipe mine out because I create so many. But these are the Jings. I think I have them back until last year, actually. Oh, February of last year. So I have Jings back until February of last year. I can click on any one of these Jings. I can look at it, I can delete it, or I can share it again. Sharing it again just gives me a link that I can share with another person after the fact. It's an easy, quick way to reuse the same video over and over again. So when you're doing your videos, just keep them generic. For example, I always have to remember, don't say people's names if I'm going to maybe use that video again. But I can open it up, I can preview it, and I can share it out to screencast with those three little arrows down here. I can also rename my Jings. If you are going to use a Jing from term or from maybe a few times, I would suggest, unless you're very, very good with dates, putting a name on your Jing. You can always name it when you create it. So, that way you know what this Jing is termed. Other than that, it's all titled or all titled with the dates that the Jing was made on. And you can edit Jings in Camtasia if you would like. You can click on the Edit in Camtasia button. How many folks use Camtasia currently? Okay. Yeah. I know Beth uses it because I was just helping. And we've got it figured out. Okay. So if you're using Camtasia, Jing is great because it integrates directly with Camtasia. You don't have to learn a new program to make significant edits to it. So I'm going to click close to get out of there. And I'm going to close out this history. The last thing in Jing is the actual capture option. And again, remember that you can capture. I'm going to try this, and I don't know if it'll work. No. You can capture either a video or an image. So I'm going to capture an image real quick. I've captured the image of my fish. I can drag them around. And Jing is not liking me recording while I'm doing this. But then I can annotate. I can highlight. If I want to send something to my students, I can highlight this in yellow and say, pay attention here to this area. And then just like with a video, I can share. Now it's important here, if you're not planning to edit this file in Camtasia at some point, that you don't hit the save button. I know a lot of people this when they're first using Jing, they always want to hit the save button because that's what we tend to be trained to do. So when you create a new Jing, you're able to name it. So, and I'm sorry if this is kind of small for folks. You give it a name, and then you have some options for how you want to share it. The best option when using Jing is to share via the screencast.com. And to do that, you see the three little arrows here. You just click that. You'll get a progress bar that'll tell you when it's done. And then what happens is a link to that gets stored on your clipboard. You can then go paste that link into an email to your students, an email in Outlook. You can paste it into an area of your course, a news announcement, wherever you want that, you can go and paste that link into your course. So I'm going to click close, and it's going to go away. So any questions on Jing? I know that was a really quick walkthrough of it, but I know a lot of people in here already use Jing, so I don't want to spend too much time. Okay, so everybody good with Jing? Jing, again, is a great, great tool. It's really helpful if you just need to answer those quick questions for your students. I use it a lot, especially at the beginning of the term, for folks who, you know, how do I register for the course? How about showing it with a video? Yeah, okay, so we'll do a quick video. I didn't know if that was pausing my audio, so I didn't want to do a video, but let's find a safe spot to open. All right. So I have this browser here. I can click on my son, and I can click on this little capture here, and I apologize here if it's going to stop my audio, but I'm going to click on the little capture, mini son, and I'm going to click here, and I'm going to say capture video. So it's letting me choose my mic. And I don't know, could you hear any of that? Okay, perfect. It grays the whole screen out, so I always worry that you can't hear me when I'm doing a video. Okay, so here's my screen, and I can tell my students, you know, go here. And sorry, I'm trying to find a safe course to go into, and I don't have a lot of those. Okay, so we'll go to the demonstration course, and I can, you know, go to content. And notice as I'm going, it's counting down my minutes. I only have 5 minutes. And once I get to the 4 minute range, it'll give me a little red warning that say you're almost out of time, hurry up. Okay, I can pause the video if I want. I do this especially if I'm waiting for something to load and it's taking a little while. Because I only have 5 minutes, I don't want to spend a lot of time waiting for something to load. I can mute my mic if I want to. Maybe somebody walks into your office and you need to mute your mic real quick so no one hears them. You can mute that and then continue on with your video. You can restart the video. Maybe, you know, somebody walks into your office and you can't mute the mic in time, so you need to restart the video. You can do that. Or you can click cancel and just delete the video altogether and restart it from that. But I'm going to record this video. I'm going to resume my recording, and I'm just clicking around. It's doing a video. And then once I'm done with the video, I just hit finish. I hit the stop button here. Brings up the screen. Okay. Again, I can give the name a name to my video. Okay. I can click and edit this video in Camtasia if I have Camtasia on my computer. I can share it to screencast.com, which is what we recommend. Unless, again, you're going to be making changes to the video in Camtasia, you don't need to hit the save button. There's no use in having the .swift file. You can't load it into my courses. It won't work for your students, so it's kind of a pointless thing. Only hit save if you plan on editing in Camtasia later. Most of the time, you'll hit the share via screencast. Okay, I'm going to click that button. It's going to again give me my load bar. And depending on the size of your video, videos that, you know, are like 5 minutes long may take longer to process. This one's going to be pretty quickly because it's only under a minute. Okay. And it works the same as the images. Once this finishes loading, it's going to put the link to it on my clipboard. So it's giving me a message. Now I can go into my class list. I can click on my student here because I want to compose an email to her. And this is a fake student. Okay, you know, help with homework one. And I can come down in here, you know, write my message, whatever it is, and then right click and paste that link into the email. So again, I didn't hit the save icon, I just hit the share, and the share gives me that link. Okay, and then I can send this video to my student as an email attachment, or not an attachment, as a link to the video. The student would then be able to click on that video and view it. Now remember, they cannot view it from a mobile device, like a tablet or a phone. That won't work for them. They have to be on a computer that supports Flash. They've got a few people typing, so I don't want to go too far. Now, if you say I sent that video and I had, you know, my next student asked me that exact same question, I can get that same video, as long as it's not specific to that student, by going to the little sun here and clicking on history. Finding that video in my history that I just created. Clicking that share icon again. It's going to process again, and it'll do it faster because it's already exists. Okay. I can go find the next student who asked me that same question. Click on their name. And then and I can't spell today apparently. And I can right click, I can control V or right click and paste that link into this email as well and send that off to that student. So I just used the same video to show two students how to do something without any extra work on my part. I just created the video once. Now, again, Jing is wonderful. It's great for those quick answers, but it's not great because you can't caption it. So if you're going to use it with your entire class, you'll want to use SnagIt instead. So before we move on to SnagIt, are there any other questions with Jing? I have somebody typing here, so I'll hold off a sec. How'd you get to the, so Hazel's asking, how did you get to the clipboard to copy link? When I share, when I click those three little arrows here, do you see those on my screen? The three little arrows for the video? Okay. When I click those and it gives me this processing, that's putting the link onto my clipboard for me. I don't do anything special. Clicking those three little arrows puts the link onto the clipboard. And then I just paste that link wherever I need that link to go. The three links, the three arrows puts it on the clipboard that which is on your computer. Did that answer your question, Beth? Yes. Be very careful with the with what you're doing with Jing. No, Beth, you don't need to open the clipboard. By clicking those three arrows, the link automatically gets placed on your clipboard. You can then go and paste that link into other areas of your course. So Terry is correct. As instructors, we need to be careful not to have any personal information, student info, as part of the video, since it seems to not to be saving the video outside the SPC website. So that's true. You do need to be very careful with what you're recording with Jing. You don't want to try your best not to get a lot of student information because it does get stored up onto the cloud. I'm having the same kind of day, Terry, so I can empathize with that. But those three little links, you're sharing by clicking those three little arrows, you're sharing that out to the screencast.com. The video gets stored on screencast.com, and you're just getting a link that you can then paste wherever you need it in the course. Again, I use Jing for very basic stuff, course introductions, and to answer specific questions for students on how to locate things in my course. So any other questions? I'm going to move on to SnagIt real quick. And if you think of anything, feel free to type them in and we will grab questions as we go. Okay, so that's Jing. Jing is that quick, easy fix to get you through the day. So the next thing we're going to look at is SnagIt. Now, SnagIt is Jing's big brother. That's what I call it because it's Jing on steroids, basically. It offers a lot of the same advantages as Jing with some other potential drawbacks, but thankfully nothing too major. So SnagIt's still very, very easy to use. Just like Jing, it puts an icon at the top of your desktop, and you can grab that when and where you need it. So if I'm working in a course and a student has a question, I can just grab SnagIt, do a quick video, and give that to the student to answer any questions they have. SnagIt's produce a file called an MP4. MP4s can be downloaded to your computer. They can be saved. I know a lot of people worry, well, if I put it up on the cloud, will it get lost? MP4s can be downloaded and saved to your computer. So there's no, unless you're, I'm not going to say there's no chance of losing it, but you have a backup on your computer to use if you need it. You can upload that MP4 up onto YouTube. You can edit it in Camtasia if you'd like. You can do a lot of things with that MP4 that you can't do with a Jing file. You can, just like with Jing, you can capture and annotate images, but you have more options into how much you capture and how many annotations you can do. There's no size limit or bandwidth limit that I know of. I've not run across one, and I've done some pretty big Snagits. Just keep in mind, students do not want to watch an hour-long video. Most of them will tune out. Keep your videos between 5 and about 7 minutes. That's what current research suggests. 7 minutes, it's like I'm losing track of my words, but 7 minutes is kind of the default right now. Any longer and you'll start losing them and you want to re-engage. So if you have a longer video, try if possible to chunk that up into smaller bits that the student can watch one at a time. You, captioning. I know this is a big discussion at the college right now. I know a lot of you will probably have questions on captioning. The official answer is if you put a video in your course, it must be captioned. And we can talk about ways to do that using YouTube, but that is the official answer when adding video to your course. Now, there are a lot of videos through the library that you can get that are already captioned, but if you plan on creating your own videos, you'll want to make sure that they are captioned if you're offering them to the entire class. Some of the cons with Snagit are it must be purchased, and I know a lot of departments purchase this for their faculty. It's $29.95 with the educational discount, so it's not that expensive. And again, I know a lot of departments have purchased it, so if you're interested, reach out to them. We don't currently have a site license. Snagit might require a little more training than Jing does, but not much. I've shown people how to use Snagit in 20 minutes. And then it's recommended that you use Snagit in conjunction with YouTube, because once you get that MP4, you need somewhere to put it. And YouTube is the best spot because it's easily accessible by students. It's easy to upload things to YouTube. Students can play YouTube videos on their phones and on their tablet devices. They don't need to be on a computer. And YouTube will auto-caption things for you to a certain extent. And Alan's correct. Once you have the MP4, please, please, please do not put it directly onto my courses. It will not work. Browsers do not like it, and my courses is not a streaming server. So once you have the MP4 from Snagit, please make sure to put that up on YouTube, or if you're using another video storage site, you can put it up on one of those as well. So Snagit, here's the link for if you want to go download Snagit again. You can get a free, I think the trial is a week long, maybe it's a little bit longer than that. But you can get a free trial of Snagit if you just want to play around with it for a few days. If you do want to purchase it, again, it is $29.95 with the educational discount. And to get that, all you need to do is use your college email when you purchase it. And Alan's correct. When you can connect a YouTube account if you have one and upload it directly from Snagit. So just like we hit that link in Jing, the three arrows, just like we hit that link in Jing to share it to our clipboard, you can do a very similar thing with Snagit, where you click one button, it automatically goes to your YouTube account if you've already got one linked. Any questions on that? I know that's a lot of info all at once. Lori's typing, so I'm going to give a minute. Okay, so let's take a look at Snagit. Because who's currently using Snagit? How many? A lot of people use Jing, I know. I'm curious how many folks are using. Haven't needed to learn how to use it. So again, Snagit takes a little more work than Jing, I think, to pick up. But once you do, it's very, very similar to Jing in a lot of ways. It has a lot of the same benefits and gives you that more reusable learning object that you can use term to term versus Jing, which tends to be one of those use it once and it's done. Snagit seems is more use it term to term and copy it with your courses. Okay, so let's take a look at Snagit. I'm going to share my desktop here again. Can everybody see my desktop? Okay. So Snagit's kind of like Jing. When you install Snagit on your computer and you have it running, it'll put a little, it doesn't put a sun up there, which I kind of wish it did because I like the sun, but it puts a little icon at the top of your desktop or at the top of your monitor for different options in Snagit. So this is your basic Snagit option. So let's bring up a course real quick. Okay, here's my class again. So just like with Jing and Snagit, you can do a video or an image. So I'm going to start by clicking on the little image. It looks like a little video or a little camera. So notice it changes the little red button. I'm going to start by clicking on that. And I'm going to capture an image of this screen. And notice it lets me choose how much of the screen that I want to capture. So if I just want to capture my news widget, I can do that. And it's going to open up the Snagit editor. Now remember, when we captured a Jing image, it gave us some basic editing rights. I could have added some text. I could highlight things, but that was pretty much it. I didn't have a lot of flexibility other than that. Snagit takes it to a whole new level. So I know a lot of people, I don't want to learn Photoshop because it's too difficult. And I agree with you. I am not a graphics expert. I'm not a graphics artist. I just want to do some basic, maybe put some borders on things and make arrows point to things. And that's why I love Snagit. It gives me just as much as I need without giving me too much to use. So this is my image file. I can then, I have all kinds of tools here. And again, Snagit has some great tutorials on how to get started with it. I'd say play with it. Go look at their tutorials. We don't have enough time in the hour we have for this to talk about every tool Snagit has. And if you want to meet with one of us, we're more than happy to meet and discuss Snagit as well. But I can come up here and I can create an arrow, and it's got predefined arrows, and I can point to the play button, and I can go in and make, give it ripped corners and curl the paper, whatever I want to do, I can do it right in Snagit. And I can put these images into my course. I can even put filters on it if you want to. That didn't really do anything, but I could put filters on it if you're familiar with Snapchat. You'd like filters. I can put spotlights, I can magnify, I can do what all the basic editing things that I need to do. I can do within Snagit. I know we use Snagit to create all of our tutorials with like arrows pointing to things and borders around things. You can do that in Snagit. You don't need a more difficult program to do it. They do have a lot of options that honestly I do not use, but I tend to stick with the arrows and the borders. Any questions on any of that before I go too far? I can also crop if I need to. I can share, I can put this image in Word. I can automatically click and send a capture to Word. And if I click on that, it's actually one of their newer features and is very helpful. And it will embed that image directly into a Word file for me. I have the same option with embedding it in PowerPoint and even Excel. I can send this to screencast.com just like I would a Jing. And I think that's the direction we're going is Snagit will eventually take Jing over. There's no official word on that, but they've been adding things recently that suggest they're going to just be they're building a lot of the Jing features into Snagit. So I can send it directly to screencast.com and get a link similar to what I'd get in Jing. I can open it in Camtasia Studio. It's not a video, so I can't send it to YouTube, but we'll look at that in a minute. If you have a Google Drive account, you can share it with your Google Drive account as well. And then you have a library, and this is where your captures are stored. So I'm going to go back to tools. Now, notice down here at the bottom is also a timeline. So these are all the things that I've done recently using Snagit, very similar to the history area in Jing. I can go back and I can reopen these and make changes to them and duplicate them and make copies and reuse. Again, the reusing is what makes this a powerful tool because I don't have to recreate everything from scratch. I can simply go back, right, and this is one of my assignments for my course. I can go back, grab this, and just add different. Maybe this time I want to focus on this area instead of the other area I focused on last time. And I can save this as a brand new image. So I don't have to go take those screenshots over and over and over again. I can reuse an existing screenshot and just make modifications to it. So any questions on images before we move on? Because I know a lot of people are more interested in the video. So I'm going to close this out because we don't need this. We'll reopen it in a minute. Okay, so I want to do a video with Snagit. So I'm going to click here on video capture. It's going to change my little red button to a video camera. And now I'm going to click on that video camera. And just like before, I can choose my capture area. I'm just going to choose to capture the course. And Snagit for me always takes a minute, but it seems to be only my computer. I can set my microphone. I can set my system audio if I want. I'm just going to click record. Notice press F, Shift F10 to stop recording. That's a keyboard shortcut. Or you can come down here and just hit the stop button, which is generally what I do because I can never remember Shift F10. Okay. So I can do the recording, and this is just like Jing. I can show my students the course. I can go to the introduction. I can say, do the first four things in this folder first, and then start on module one and do this. So I can do a nice presentation for my students. The good thing is, this is the kind of video that I could use with all of my courses that are, maybe I'm teaching several of the same course. Or if I keep it generic enough, I can use it from term to term. I know that's not always possible, but some of those videos that you create do apply term to term in your courses. So I'll make my video, and when I'm done, I'll just hit the stop button to finish my recording. And once again, it takes me to the Snagit editor. With videos, you don't have as many options. Of course, you can't annotate and things like that. But what you can do is share. And this is what Alan was referring to a little while ago. You can share directly to YouTube. So you can go in here, click on the down arrow next to YouTube, click on account, and you can sign in to your YouTube account. Now, I'm not signed in for various reasons because I have too many accounts, but you can sign in to your account in YouTube. You only have to do that once. And it should remember your sign-in after that. And then from then on, you can just click on the YouTube button. And if you were signed in, the video would automatically be direct or uploaded up to YouTube. Any questions on that? And again, just like with the image files I got, notice my videos are stored down here in the bottom. I can go back and look at older videos. I can repurpose them. I can use and share them again if I need to. They're not gone. If you just want to share this as an MP4 or save it as an MP4 and download it to your computer, and maybe you have a different sharing site, you can do that by going up here to File and Save As, and just saving it as the standard format, which is an MP4, and then save that on your computer, wherever you want to store your files. You can also send the video directly to Camtasia if you're going to be doing any editing, or if you're recording multiple videos and you want to edit them in Camtasia, that's your next step. And again, just like with Jing, I can send them straight to screencast.com and get a link that I can then send to my students as well. And Dodie's typing in, so I want to give you a minute to. Any questions on Snagit? I know we went through both of those really, really quickly. Okay. Michelle, and in doing a narrated PowerPoint, would this be an option, or do you recommend narrated PowerPoint in Camtasia? I would say if you're doing a narrated PowerPoint, probably stick with Camtasia. I think it's a better option. This is more of an option if you're recording maybe your course, or there's a website that you have your students navigate a lot and you want to show a screen recording. Personally, when I used to grade a different way, I would provide feedback to my students. I would download their assignments, and I teach CGS 1100, so I would download their assignments, and especially in Excel where they make the same mistakes over and over again. I would do a video of how to fix the mistakes, not just, you did this wrong and this is where your points came off, but I would use video to give them feedback. And for me, it was a lot faster than trying to type that into an email or a feedback box. I just did a video. It took 5 minutes instead of 20 to get feedback. And I think the feedback was better accepted because I could put my voice with it. It didn't come off as so harsh. Lori, can you show us how to edit the captioning after the video is on YouTube? Yeah, we can go through that real quick, Lori. I'll log into YouTube. I think I have a video I need to do anyway. So as Alan said, we have another web our virtual session coming up in July. It's called PowerPoint. There's a new add-on for PowerPoint. It's called PowerPoint Mix. Dodie, that'll answer your question, I think, especially. So if you can't attend that, make sure to get the recorded session for it. It's an add-on that you can put directly into PowerPoint, which makes your PowerPoints more engaging. You can put annotations, you can put videos, you can put and Alan knows more about it, so he can give more feedback. But it's a really, really great new tool that Microsoft just launched. And it integrates directly into your PowerPoint, so you're already halfway there by having the PowerPoint. You don't have to create anything new. So any questions on the difference between Jing and Snagit, or why you use one instead of the other? So this is just a quick breakdown why you'd want to use Jing versus Snagit. Jing videos are they're your disposable videos. They're your one-time, maybe two-time quick answer to something. But if it's a question you're going to be answering a lot, I would say just go with Snagit. Snagit's really nice, but it does come with a cost. It's $29.95, and it does take a little bit more getting used to, but I think once you do, it's well worth it. And you can do a lot of the same things in Snagit that you can do with Jing. So really, you only have to learn one product instead of two if you're going to go with Snagit. And I've slowly been moving myself to Snagit. I had a lot hard time giving up Jing, and I was still send Jings. But I am slowly getting toward the Snagit way of thinking. So where do you go for help? The links here directly are take you straight to the websites to get help. Again, they have lots of tutorials, lots of videos on how to get started with these tools. They're great. They really help for folks wanting to learn more. And they'll show you things that we didn't get a chance to cover here, more advanced things that you can do using either of these tools. So make sure to check those out. Also, especially with Snagit, there's a community out there, a TechSmith community of other users just like you looking for ways to do interesting things in their courses. So go on to the free community. You can suggest upgrades to the tool. Maybe there's something you want to do that you can't, or you want to search the community on to see what other people are doing with their Snagits. There's a lot of people doing a lot of very interesting things. So definitely take a look at that if you have a chance. It's a great community to join. So the next step, we talked about adding videos to your course, but we looked at two of the tools, and these are two common tools, but there are next steps here. If you want to work more with the video, I would suggest you take the YouTube course, and I'll show you in just a sec how to sign up for that course. It works great in conjunction with Snagit. It helps you to caption your videos quickly. You can reuse it term to term, and students can then access your video from their mobile devices, their smartphones, or their tablets. Also, if you're interested in a lot of video editing, you'll want to also look at the Camtasia courses, and we currently have two. We have a basic introduction to Camtasia if Camtasia is new to you. And then you have an advanced one as well. If you're already well versed in Camtasia, there is an advanced Camtasia. Oh, thank you, Beth. PowerPoint is not available for Mac OS X, only Windows. Carlos, do you have Office for Mac? Okay. Then hopefully it'll be a something they add soon. So we'll make sure to mention that on that webinar. So real quick, I want to show you just in case you don't know, because we haven't sent out an email lately on how to register for those courses. If you're interested in taking YouTube or Camtasia or any of the other courses we offer. If you go into My Courses, in the top right-hand side, there's a self-registration link. If you click on self-registration, we have all the courses that we currently offer. These are online, self-paced courses. There's a certificate at the end, but there's currently no requirement that you have to take these courses. They're optional at the moment. So you can go in if there's anything that strikes you as interesting. All you need to do is click on the course. Oops, sorry, I'm an editor, so I see things a little bit differently. You would just click on the course to be registered, and then you would be in that course and could access the information in that course. We have courses on Capture, Softalk, Camtasia, YouTube, end dates, our start, due, and end dates, rubrics, flipping the classroom. We have lots, and we'll be announcing a lot more coming up. And we do try to make sure that what we offer crosses several platforms. So if there's anything you don't see here that you'd like to learn more about, let us know. We're constantly adding to these. So I'm going to answer Lori's question real quick on how to caption a YouTube video. Are there any other questions on Snagit or Jing before we go get there? Okay. So we're going to take just a minute to look at how to edit a caption in YouTube. If you want to stay, feel free. This is not part of the advertised portion of this course, but if you're interested in how to caption using YouTube, we'll go through it real quick. But other than that, if you have any questions, please email mycoursesforfaculty@spcollege.edu. We're happy to answer any questions you have on Jing or SnagIt. Remember, they do have tutorials, but if you're not finding the one that meets your needs, of course, send us an email and we will get back with you just as quick as we can. You can also call us at 727-341-3500. That's our number. Four of us monitor that call, that number, so you will probably get an answer right away. And if not, somebody will call you back right away. Thank you, Alan. And Alan put the email and the phone number into the chat window. If you go out and use these tools, if you have any recommendations or you see any other tools that we didn't cover here, of course, let us know. We're always on the lookout for new tools that might help you add engagement to your course, but not add a lot of workload to your course. I know we're all busy and don't have a lot of time to learn new a lot of new things. So anytime we can reuse, that's great. Awesome. Okay, so I'm going to go over to YouTube real quick. And like I said, I apologize in advance. I have a lot of YouTube accounts, so I don't know which one I'm logged into now. But I'm going to my YouTube account. Apparently, I'm not logged into any right now. Oh, here's one. Okay. Okay, so this is a video I did for my student the other day. I need to caption this. Okay, so I'm going to click on this video. And this is speaking to Lori's question about how do you caption, how do you edit the captioning of a video that already exists in YouTube. And this is, Lori, this is a video I did. I don't know if you're referring to a video that you don't own or a video you do own. If it's a video you don't own, let us know. That's a different process. But this is a video that I uploaded the other day that I still need to caption before my students get to. Okay, so one you've done on Snagit. So you've uploaded the video to YouTube and now you're ready to caption that video. I did this video on Snagit for a student. This module is getting ready to open next week, so I definitely want to get this captioned before my students get to the video. So I'm going to click on the video on YouTube and I'm logged into my YouTube account. That's very important. Under the video, there's a CC option. I can click on that CC option. And it's going to take me to the captioning area of YouTube. I'm going to pause this because I don't want to listen to it. Now, I have the English automatic subtitles that YouTube tries its best to generate subtitles for you or captions for you. It doesn't want to, it's not always perfect though. There, you do need to modify it a little bit. If you've ever looked at a YouTube video, the captioning that's just done auto captioning, oftentimes somebody's killed a bear or eaten a shoe, or because YouTube's not perfect, it tries its best to auto caption for you. So I'm going to click on the English automatic caption, and it's going to give me what it was able to do without any interference from me. So once I click on that, I can, if this is good, I would just leave it alone, but it's rarely good. So I'm going to click on edit in the bottom right-hand corner to edit these existing captions here. Now, the great thing about the auto captioning is that it puts the timestamps in for you, so you don't have to do that, and that saves a tremendous amount of time. And once I click on edit, I can just go through each of the screens, make any changes that I need to do to my video. Yeah, and Alan's correct. Generally, it's about 80 to 90% good. It really depends on if you come with at it with an accent. I know sometimes my southern accent will be more southern than other times, and YouTube has a hard time captioning that. I've heard other people with different accents, it has a harder time picking up, especially thicker accents. And I also think as you do more captioning, you just get better at recognizing where YouTube's going to have a problem captioning you, and I think you adjust for that in your speaking. I know I have. For example, I say fur instead of four, And now that I've done a lot of these videos and a lot of captioning, I make myself mentally say for instead of fur. Again, I'm from right outside Alabama, so it makes complete sense where I'm from, but YouTube doesn't understand that narration. And it's getting better. I think they did something in December that went that proved it a lot, because I know the last couple of videos I've had to do haven't been nearly as bad. And again, I think that's partially because I've learned how YouTube captions, but it's I think also YouTube's getting better at auto captioning for us. So that request for, real-time automatic captioning, I think we're on our way. We're not there yet. So I would just go down this list, make my changes. I can play the video. That'll help me, because sometimes I don't remember what I was saying and the captioning doesn't give me any clues. I can play the video, listen, and type in what I want. I can go down, and this is a pretty long video for me. Oh, this is a long video. Sorry about that. I would just make all the changes to my captions, and at the end, I would click Publish Edits. Once I hit Publish Edits, that's the new caption for my YouTube video. That's all I need to do. Any questions on that? Okay, cool. If you want to learn more about YouTube, again, we have the YouTube course. Or if you want to meet with one of us, we're happy to meet with you as well. Just send us an email. And how many times you can edit as many times as you need. So if you get started on a video and you can't finish the editing before you leave, you can come back at any point and start editing that video again.
Michelle, do you hear me? Michelle, everybody?
Yes, definitely. Support is available. Again, it's my courses for faculty at spcollege.edu is probably the easiest way to get back with us. We will respond, and if you want, if you put your phone number in, we'll also call you right back if you prefer a phone call.
Michelle, I wanted to make out one other point.
So I hope this was useful. We have lots of other webinars planned for this summer. Again, we have a lot of pedagogy and technology. Later this week on Thursday, Richard Mercadante will be presenting on common mistakes students make when communicating. He's presented this a lot in his own classes, and he's going to revise it for the faculty perspective, and he'll be presenting that on Thursday. And then next week we have a presentation by Paul Phipps on 12 Angry Students, and this is one that he did at the SPC Teaching and Learning Conference back in April. For those unable to attend, we wanted to provide a webinar version of it as well. It was really well attended, and we have a lot of positive feedback on it. So we wanted to invite him to do that as a webinar for those not able to attend that session. And then we have a lot more. So again, Alan's doing one later in July called Mix, Enhancing Your PowerPoints. We've got a couple on YouTube, or not on YouTube. On my courses, we've got some on library resources, finding already captioned videos. I know a lot of people want to maybe save yourself from captioning and find videos that are already captioned for you. And the library has a lot of new databases to help you.
Not sure you can hear me, Michelle. Can everybody
But
else hear me?
that's. Oh, I'm sorry, Alan. I didn't see your.
No, I don't know
I
if
can
everybody
hear
else
you.
can hear me. I just wanted to make a point about the captioning. After you click Publish Edit, one of the things that I suggest is to disable the automatic one. No worries, Michelle. So that's just an important point, because you'll actually end up with two, and somebody in there can actually click on the automatic ones, and they would still see them in the, when you once you publish edit. So I just want to make that point out, that after you click publish edits, there is a way to right click on the one that says English automatic and disable it. So somebody shouldn't have to click on that. Oh, that's why you can't hear me. That's why we're getting feedback. So can you click on Publish Edit, Michelle?
Almost said it. Okay.
So, and right click on the one that says English Automatic. And you should be able to disable, or there's a way. No, I'm sorry. That's right. No, I'm sorry. Click on the one that says English automatic now. This is what you click on it, not right click. And then up at actions. Yeah, I forgot about that. That's where it is. Go to actions and
Unpublished.
unpublish. Yeah. So you want to unpublish the one. Otherwise, when somebody goes to the YouTube, it will automatically, it'll go to the English one, but the other one will still be there and they could actually click on that. I just wanted to make that point.
Yes, thank
Thanks.
you. I'd forgotten about that. Any other questions before we head out for the day? We're a little over time, but if there's anything you have, feel free to call us, email us, or we'll stay on for a few more minutes in case you want to stick around the chat and ask any questions.